Hello, welcome to one of the most environmentally advanced buildings in the world. My colleagues and I are going to give you a brief tour of the Kendeda Building for Innovative Sustainable Design at the Georgia Institute of Technology campus in Atlanta. This is a multidisciplinary, non-departmental education building that opened in late 2019. The Kendeda Building site is approximately 1.35 acres. The building has 47,000 square feet of programmable space, of which nearly 37,000 square feet is enclosed and conditioned. It has one auditorium, two classrooms, four class labs, meeting rooms, lots of common areas, and an office for co-located programs. It also hosts a student-run bio-inspired makerspace, and one of the most popular features is its rooftop that has an apiary and plots for farming. In 2021, it became the first building in the Southeast certified to Living Building Challenge version 3.1. And that's why we can praise its environmental performance.
Sustainable buildings are great. If constructed properly, they use less energy and water, consume fewer resources, and are healthier for occupants. The Living Building Challenge seeks to go beyond sustainability and create regenerative buildings. In other words, buildings that give back more to the environment than they take.
The Kendeda Building exemplifies this regenerative approach. Through energy efficiency and on-site solar, it produces about 200% more electricity each year than it consumes. The site virtually eliminates stormwater, which would otherwise negatively affect downstream communities. Its bathrooms don't even connect to the sewer. During construction, we diverted more waste from the landfill than we sent to the landfill. These are just a few of the regenerative features that we will showcase.
The Living Building Challenge uses flowers as a metaphor to explain regenerative buildings. Like flowers, buildings should take everything they need from their site. When a building is gone, it should leave more than it took. Flowers do this. They leave behind seeds. Therefore, the Living Building Challenge is framed around performance areas called petals. Version 3.1 has 7 petals: place, water, energy, health and happiness, materials, equity, and beauty.
Projects have to satisfy approximately 300 requirements to achieve full Living Building Challenge certification. They must also prove net positive energy, net positive water, and strict indoor air quality during a 12-month performance period after the building opens. That's why it's called a challenge.
The Kendeda Fund, an Atlanta-based philanthropy, envisioned a living building in the Southeast United States that meets this challenge in order to prove that regenerative buildings can be constructed in our climate. They selected Georgia Tech as their partner, in part because we have a long history of environmental stewardship. Before this building, we had dozens of LEED certified sustainable buildings, multiple facilities with rooftop solar arrays, and a campus-wide stormwater reduction effort known as the Eco Commons. Our researchers and academics were, and continue to be, globally recognized as innovators in fields such as solar, materials, and sustainable policy.
Georgia Tech is leading by example and proving that owners across the Southeast can construct buildings that foster regenerative and restorative relationships amongst humans and nature. Our living building experience has influenced other buildings on campus and plans such as Sustainability Next, which is Georgia Tech's sustainability plan. We amplify impact by facilitating conversations on how to incorporate regenerative features into other buildings across the world. There's one more reason why it is fitting for Georgia Tech to have a living building. We are committed to developing leaders who advance technology and improve the human condition. Students who take classes in this building are seeds. The knowledge they gain here may germinate into solutions that benefit all. If you stay for the rest of this tour, you're going to learn something that you will never forget. And maybe you will improve the world.
And with that introduction, let's talk about specifics. All buildings begin with the place petal. This site was once a parking lot. We removed the asphalt, recycled it, and replaced it with a forest. Well, a regenerative building that functions like Atlanta's forest ecosystem, where it rains a lot. Therefore, the project team designed the site to mimic nature. I'll show you an example. Here we have two sidewalks. One is a conventional sidewalk and the other is in the Living Building Challenge site. Pretend that this jug is filled with rainfall. The conventional sidewalk turns rain into stormwater that ultimately goes into a drain, which costs money to construct and maintain. drains do not solve the stormwater problem, rather they make it someone else's problem. Our region has combined sewers that transport stormwater and sewage to treatment plants. Heavy rains sometimes overwhelm the system and cause sewage spills. This is an environmental and equity issue for residents who live close to wastewater treatment plants, not to mention everything downstream. The conventional sidewalk is single-use infrastructure that does one thing. It provides space for walking, but in the process creates a stormwater nuisance. In contrast, the regenerative sidewalk allows for rainfall to seep into the ground. It is multi-use infrastructure that provides space for walking and manages rain like a forest. In fact, to become Living Building Challenge certified, every aspect of a project must accomplish multiple requirements. For example, the solar canopy generates electricity, but it also has gutters that capture rainfall for storage and slow release into the site. These pervious pavers and the permeable concrete are like soil. You can walk on them and rain can go through them. These bioswales are beautiful gardens that fill up with rainfall during exceptionally strong storms. This allows the soil to slowly absorb excess water. By incorporating multi-use infrastructure and functioning like a forest, we have virtually eliminated stormwater from our site.
In addition to rainfall, buildings also have to manage other types of water to satisfy the Living Building Challenge net positive water requirement. For example, condensate from the building's dehumidification system is used for landscape irrigation. Gray water, which is what's left over after you wash your hands or take a shower, ends up here in this constructed wetland. Plant roots filter and clean the gray water, which is then released into the ground. And another type of water is the icky stuff. We'll talk about that later. I thought I said later. Well, because you're here, let's talk about it. In conventional buildings, we flush drinking water and electricity down the toilet. Our region uses electricity to transport water from reservoirs to central plants that consume more electricity to purify the water to drinking levels. Then electric pumps transport drinking water to buildings where much of it is flushed down the toilet. That icky water is conveyed to wastewater treatment plants, which use more energy to bring it to a level that's safe to discharge. As we've already discussed, this system can result in sewage spills. As if that's not enough, some of the electricity used to make drinking water is generated by burning fossil fuels. Therefore, to address environmental and equity issues, as well as global climate change, we should stop constructing buildings that force people to go to the bathroom in so much drinking water. The Kendeda Building provides an alternative. This building has waterless urinals and composting toilets, which use ounces of drinking water to coat the sides of the bowl with biodegradable foam. The foam carries deposits into one of six bins in the basement. Inside the bins, microbes digest all the deposits. About once a month, we send the compost liquids to an off-site facility for beneficial reuse, and it will take the compost solids a decade to accumulate. So, while you learn more about the energy pedal, I'm just gonna stay here and make some compost.
No matter where you are in the world, focus on energy efficiency first and on-site renewables second. The Kendeda Building is 80% more efficient than a similar building constructed in this climate zone. The way to get to that level of efficiency is as follows. First, design as if there is no mechanical heating and cooling. You know, the way civilizations design buildings for millennia. The Kendeda Building faces west into the setting sun so that occupants can gaze onto the beautiful eco commons. A west-facing building normally results in summertime heat gain. Rather than install more air conditioning that would increase electricity demand, the project team applied a design technique used for our region's homes prior to the adoption of air conditioning, a front porch and a canopy. The Kendeda Building's regenerative front porch is shaded by the solar canopy, which also shades the second floor of this building. This passive design reduced the building's electricity demand for cooling. The second step to energy efficiency is to construct the building well, with the right amount of insulation and with energy-efficient windows that provide plenty of natural light. Also, test for and plug air leaks before installing the drywall. By employing these techniques, the building has a tight thermal envelope. This allows it to maintain temperature longer,
which reduces the need for heating and cooling. The third step is to use energy-efficient mechanical systems. Instead of traditional heating and cooling, the Kendeda Building employs a dedicated outdoor air system known as a DOAS, which acts like the building's lungs. During the summer, it exhales cooler indoor air and inhales hotter outdoor air. Inside the DOAS, a thermal wheel transfers energy from the incoming air to the outgoing air. This reduces the temperature of the incoming hot air. A separate chamber dehumidifies and further cools the incoming air. During winter, the concept works in reverse. When it gets really hot or cold, we have a trick up our sleeve, or rather a trick below our feet, where beneath the concrete we have water pipes. In the summertime, cold water runs through them. In the wintertime, it's hot water. We take advantage of the thermal properties of the concrete that slowly radiates that cool or warmth. Another component to thermal comfort in the summer is energy-efficient fans that create a breeze for building occupants. Maximizing efficiency allows us to install the optimal amount of renewable energy. We have a 330-kilowatt solar array. For each of the first 4 years the building was open, it achieved over 200% net positive energy. The Living Building Challenge requirement was 105%. Can buildings in the Southeast achieve net positive energy? Yep. Check our website for the latest energy performance data.
Oh, welcome back. Well, now I'm ready to talk about the materials pedal. Let me show you something. This used to be slate tile on the roof of Georgia Tech's alumni house, and now it's slate tile on the walls of this bathroom. This ramp is made from wood that we salvaged from a demolished building. This beautiful countertop is made from a tree that fell down on campus. We also converted original pine joists from Georgia Tech Tower into treads for the Kendeda Building's monumental staircase. If building materials can be reused, then why are we throwing them away? The next time you see a new building being constructed, pay attention to the dumpster full of scrap wood, tile, and other supplies. The owner pays for the discarded material. The system as it currently exists makes it cheaper to throw materials away than to do what we did. During construction, we recycled the bulk of our unused material. Only 0.5% was thrown away. We then relied on local labor to deconstruct buildings, divert other reusable materials from the landfill, mill them into new building components, and then install the salvaged materials in this building. That is how we got to net negative waste during construction. We like to think of this approach as the salvage economy, through which we can create a new industry that both reduces waste and generates local jobs.
Almost all packaged food and drink items have labels to inform consumers about nutrition and ingredients. Do you have any idea about what's in the paint, carpet, or materials in a room when you walk into it? The Living Building Challenge requires project teams to vet materials against a red list of worst-in-class chemicals that pose harm to human health and the natural environment. This is one of the hardest requirements for project teams to meet. Fortunately, consumers are increasingly demanding product transparency. There are green product labels like the Declare label, Cradle to Cradle, and others that help owners make informed decisions on what to put in their buildings. There's more to discuss. However, we don't want to keep you much longer. Our website has additional information. And keep in mind that the Living Building Challenge itself is evolving. Visit the International Living Future Institute website to get the latest information on the Living Building Challenge, Declare label, and other certifications.
If there's one thing we want you to remember from this tour, it's that when designing a building, we should pretend that there's no mechanical heating and cooling. Okay, two things. We should respect drinking water. All right, three things. Single-use infrastructure is a luxury civilization cannot afford. For every idea, the Kendeda Building design team asked, how can we make this multi-use? Take our ceiling, for example. I'll count the ways that it's satisfied many Living Building Challenge requirements. This building had to begin its life having zero carbon impact. Did you know that there is a technology which takes atmospheric carbon dioxide and turns it into a building product? It's called a tree, and the Southeast leads in this technology. That's number one. We used a lot of wood because of its carbon benefits. Two, the wood is from sustainable tree farms. 3, to reduce carbon emissions from transportation, we source the timber within 1,000 kilometers of this site. Near sourcing also keeps money flowing locally. Impressed? Well, there's more. The ceiling's also beautiful. At least we think so. It's made of 2x4s and 2x6s nailed together to create a visually appealing complement to the smooth concrete floor. To keep materials out of the landfill, we incorporated salvaged 2x4s from Atlanta's film industry. While assembling the ceiling, we had thousands of leftover pieces that we turned into stairs. By the way, I've lost count, but you get the idea. This ceiling is multi-use. We could have patted ourselves on the back and moved on. However, because that multi-use seed had germinated, we asked ourselves, what does a building mean for equity? This question led us to a partnership with Georgia Works, a local workforce development nonprofit that helps people at risk of chronic homelessness. 6 individuals from that program helped us construct this ceiling and received marketable skills. We think that this is one of the lasting legacies of this project and is a prime example of how multi-use thinking can result in buildings that are better for occupants, the community, and the environment.
If you're still on this tour, thanks.
Living buildings can be overwhelming.
Think of it this way. Visiting a fully certified living building is like walking into a restaurant and ordering everything on the menu.
An all-organic, local harvest, vegan restaurant, of course.
No matter what you're trying to build, a regenerative approach can show you how to do that one thing better. We met the challenge. Now we challenge you to rethink what your expectations are of a building. Challenge your policymakers, employers, schools, and governments to take us to a regenerative future. Thank you very much. This jug is filled with rainfall.
Did you get that?
Is that going in our blooper reel?
No. The knowledge they gain here may germinate into solutions that benefit. Ugh. Sorry. It's a lot to say at one time. In the world. My colleagues and I are going. Straight up bumped into me.